Hello students, today we shall study chapter number 2 of your book Flamingo, and the name of the chapter is Lost Spring, Stories of Stolen Childhood. It is written by Anis Young. She was born in India. She got her education in Hyderabad and United States of America. Her parents were also writers. Anis began her career as a writer in India. She has been an editor and columnist for major newspapers in India and abroad. And in this chapter, she writes about her experiences after meeting some children from the poorest strata of society. And she analyzes that grinding poverty and tradition are two major concerns that compel these children to lead a life of poverty and exploitation. Fine, let us find. This chapter has two parts, rather it has two stories in one chapter. The first story is, sometimes I find a rupee in a garbage. Let us read. Why do you do this? I ask Sahib, whom I encounter every morning scrounging for gold in the garbage dumps of my neighborhood. Here, this chapter is again written in first person narrative, and I is our writer here, and Sahib is a boy who meets writer every morning. And what does Sahib do? He scrounges for gold in the garbage. Here, scrounging for gold in the garbage is a very beautiful expression. Scrounging here means searching, hunting about, finding. And gold in the garbage. So here gold doesn't mean gold metal. Here gold means something valuable. Sahib left his home long ago, set amidst the green fields of Dhaka. His home is not even a distant memory. There were many storms that swept away their fields and homes. His mother tells him that is why they left, looking for gold in the big city where he now lives. So Sahib-e-Alam is from Bangladesh, and he is a rag picker who does not go to school. And why they have settled here? They have settled here because their homes and fields were swept away by storm. I have nothing else to do, he mutters, looking away. Go to school, I say glibly, realizing immediately how hollow the advice must sound. The author gave him suggestion, why don't you go to school? She knows very well this advice was hollow. She doesn't mean that. There is no school in my neighborhood. When they build one, I will go. So this was the answer from Sahib, that there was no school in their neighborhood. If I start a school, will you come? I ask, half joking. Yes, he says, smiling broadly. A few days later, I see him running up to me. Is your school ready? It takes longer to build a school, I say, embarrassed at having made a promise that was not meant. But promises like mine abound in every corner of his bleak world. Very interesting. Here, the writer is embarrassed because she made a promise to him that she is going to open a school, but she couldn't do that. Out of enthusiasm to help the boy, she promises that she will open a school in his neighborhood, but later feels embarrassed for making a promise that she cannot keep. Fine. Another interesting thing she shares, that promises like mine abound in every corner of his bleak world. Bleak here means black, dull, foggy, without hope. So these boys are living in a world which is black for them, hopeless, foggy for them. They have no hope. These promises are many in their lives. After months of knowing him, I ask him his name, Sahib-e-Alam. He announces he does not know what it means. If he knew its meaning, Lord of the Universe, he would have a hard time believing it. This is reality, because this boy is living a very miserable life. And if he comes to know that the meaning of his name is Lord of the Universe, he is not going to believe it. Unaware of what his name represents, he roams the street with his friends, an army of barefoot boys who appear like the morning birds and disappear at noon. Over the months, I have come to recognize each of them. Why aren't you wearing chappals? I ask one. So over a period of time, she meets more boys like Sahib and notices that none of these children have worn shoes. So she asks one day to one boy, why aren't you wearing chappals? My mother did not bring them down from the shelf. He answers simply. Even if she did, he will throw them off. Adds another who is wearing shoes that do not match. When I comment on it, he shuffles his feet and says nothing. I want shoes, says a third boy, who has never owned a pair all his life. Traveling across the country, I have seen children walking barefoot in cities, on village roads. It is not lack of money, but a tradition to stay barefoot is one explanation. An analysis reveals that this practice is more due to lack of resource than a matter of habit. Because, the writer says, I wonder if this is only an excuse to explain away a perpetual state of poverty. The writer doesn't accept that they are not wearing chappals because of tradition. She says this is because of perpetual state of poverty. Fine. So I remember a story. This is a small story that is nothing to do much with the chapter. Let us proceed further. My acquaintance with the boy or barefoot rag pickers leads me to Simapuri, a place on the periphery of Delhi, at miles away from it metaphorically. Very interesting. This chapter is replete of so many good quotations. My acquaintance with the barefoot rag pickers leads me to Simapuri. So they belong to Simapuri. She visits their slum, Simapuri, in order to grasp their plight in a better way. And she pained to see their pathetic living condition. And Simapuri has been described here as a place on the periphery of Delhi, at miles away from it metaphorically. Literally, the place Simapuri is on the outskirts of Delhi, on the boundary of Delhi, you can say. But metaphorically, it is miles away from it because it is devoid of basic things. No sewage, no drainage, no running water, nothing. They have no facility at all, although they are living in the capital of a country. Those who live in here are squatters who came from Bangladesh back in 1971. Squatters here means those who settle on public land without any legal right. So they came in 1971. Sahib's family is among them. Simapuri was then a wilderness. It still is, but it is no longer empty. In structures of mud with roofs of tin and tarpaulin, devoid of sewage, drainage, or running water, live 10,000 rag pickers. They have lived here for more than 30 years without an identity, without permits, but with ration cards that get their names on voter list and enable them to buy grain. Food is more important for survival than an identity. If at the end of the day we can feed our families and go to bed without an aching stomach, we would rather live here than in the fields that gave us no grain. Say a group of women in tattered saris, when I ask them why they left their beautiful land of green fields and rivers. Wherever they find food, they pitch their tents that become transit homes. Children grow up in them, becoming partners in survival. So here very interesting thing is highlighted, that the people prefer that they get two-time meals. If at the end of the day we can feed our families and go to bed without an aching stomach, we would rather live here than in the fields that gave us no grain. तो वेर एवर दे फाइंड फूड दे पिच दैट टेंट एंड चिल्ड्रन ग्रो अप इन दैम बिकमिंग पार्टनर इन सर्वाइवल एंड सर्वाइवल इन सीमापुरी मीन्स रैग पिकिंग वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग. तो दे आर लिविंग इन सीमापुरी दे हैव नथिंग टू डू देयर एक्सेप्ट रैग पिकिंग. दे हैव नो अदर ऑप्शन. दे हैव नो ऑप्शन फॉर अदर वर्क. नो जॉब नो वर्क. ओनली वन थिंग दे हैव रैग पिकिंग. They have garbage over there. They go for rag picking. Through the years, it had acquired the proportions of a fine art. Garbage to them is gold. It is their daily bread. A roof over their heads, even if it is a leaking roof. But for a child, it is even more. Very interesting. So for them, garbage is everything. Garbage to them is gold. Very beautiful expression. They have one thing from which they can earn their livelihood, and that is garbage. And that is why it is described as gold. Gold here means valuable thing. So garbage is most important thing for them. From there only they get their daily bread. It is a kind of roof over their heads, even if it is a leaking roof. But for a child, it is even more. I sometimes find a rupee, even a 10 rupee note, Sahib says, his eyes lighting up. When you can find a silver coin in a heap of garbage, you don't stop scrounging, for there is hope of finding more. It seems that for children, garbage has a meaning different from what it means to their parents. Very interesting. For the children, it is wrapped in wonder. Garbage ka meaning parents ke liye alag hai, bachcho ke liye alag hai. For parents, it is a means of survival. For children, it is wrapped in wonder. Fine. One winter morning, I see Sahib standing by the fenced gate on the neighborhood club, watching two young men dressed in white, playing tennis. I like the game. He hums. Content to watch it standing behind the fence, I go. I go inside when no one is around, he admits. The gatekeeper let me use the swing. Sahib too is wearing tennis shoes that look strange over his discolored shirt and shorts. Someone gave them to me. So he accepts that these shoes were given to him. And this he says in a manner of an explanation. The fact that they are discarded shoes. Discarded, thrown away as useless. Of some rich boy who perhaps refused to wear them because of a hole in one of them. It does not bother him. The shoe with a hole does not bother him. Why? For one who has walked barefoot, even shoes with a hole is a dream come true. Very interesting. For one who has walked barefoot, even shoes with a hole is a dream come true. Fine. But the game he is watching so intently is out of his reach. This thing is that he is poor, he belongs to a very poor family, and this game is away from his reach. This morning Sahib is on his way to the milk booth. So this way we try to understand the only benefit these refugees have is an Indian ration card that enables them to buy grains. They are compelled to accept their fate, for they have little choices in the field life. Picking garbage is their sole meaning for survival. And Anis meets Sahib again after a gap of few days. She hoped to see some positive change in his life. But let us see what happens. I now work in a tea stall down the road, he says, pointing in the distance. I am paid 800 rupees and all my meals. Does he like the job? I ask. His face, I see, has lost the carefree look. So it was painful to learn that in his attempt to procure a better life, Sahib has moved from one stage of exploitation to another. Earlier, he was a rag picker. This was also a kind of exploitation. As a child, he was working. Now, as a child, again, he is working in a tea stall. And he doesn't like that work. The steel canister seems heavier than the plastic bag he would carry so lightly over his shoulder. The bag was his. This boy realizes the steel canister is heavier than his bag because the bag was his and the canister belongs to the man who owns the tea shop. He now works for a tea stall owner and carries a milk canister which is heavier than his rag bag. As a rag picker, at least he was his own master. But now, as a worker on tea stall, he was no longer his own master. He has to work on somebody else's decisions. Fine. So this way, this first part of this chapter ends with a very prominent sentence: Sahib is no longer his own master. Fine. Let us read further. Okay, student, let us further read the chapter Lost Spring, second part, I Want to Drive a Car. Mukesh insists on being his own master. I will be a motor mechanic, he announces. Do you know anything about cars? I ask. I will learn to drive a car, he answers. Looking straight into my eyes, his dream looms like a mirage amidst the dust of street that fill his town, Firozabad, famous for its bangles. Every other family in Firozabad is engaged in making bangles. It is the center of India's glass blowing industry, where families have spent generations working around furnaces, welding glass, making bangles for all the women in the land, it seems. So, students, Mukesh is born into a family of bangle makers of Firozabad. Almost every family in the shanty town is engaged in making glass bangles. They make beautiful bangles for Indian women all over the country. Mukesh belongs to a family of bangle makers who have been making bangles for generations. In fact, it is their caste, and nobody ever thinks of doing something different, but Mukesh does. He wants to be a motor mechanic. And if you focus, the very first sentence is in contrast with the last sentence of first story. Sahib is no longer his own master, but Mukesh insists on being his own master. Fine. Mukesh's family is among them. None of them know that it is illegal for children like him to work in the glass furnaces with high temperatures, in dingy cells without air and light, that the law, if enforced, could get him and all those 20,000 children out of the hot furnaces where they slog their daylight hours, often losing the brightness of their eyes. Mukesh's eyes beam as he volunteers to take me home, which he proudly says is being rebuilt. We walk down stinking lanes choked with garbage, past homes that remain hovels with crumbling walls. Hovels, you understand? Small dirty house. Crumbling walls, crumbling, falling apart. Those which are not in good condition. Fine. And wobbly, shaky. We walk down stinking lanes choked with garbage, past homes that remain hovels with crumbling walls, wobbly doors, no windows, crowded with families of humans and animals coexisting in a primal state. One day, the author visits his house, and which he proudly says is being rebuilt. They go through a stinking lane choked with garbage. All the houses are old with crumbling walls and shaky doors. Humans and animals live together, and Mukesh's house is like any other house in the lane. It is half built shake. He stops at the door of one such house, bangs a wobbly iron door with his foot and pushes it open. We enter a half built shack. In one part of it, thatched with dead grass, is a firewood stove, over which sits a large vessel of sizzling spinach leaves,
on the ground in large aluminium platters are more chopped vegetables. A frail young woman is cooking the evening meal for the whole family. Through eyes filled with smoke, she smiles. She is the wife of Mukesh's elder brother. Not much older in years, she has begun to command respect as the Bahu. The daughter-in-law of the house, already in charge of three men, her husband, Mukesh, and their father. When the older man enters, she gently withdraws behind the broken wall and brings her veil closer to her face, as custom demands. Daughters-in-law must veil their faces before male elders. In this case, the elder is an impoverished bangle maker. So, in a half-built shack, under a shed, a frail young woman is busy preparing the evening meals. It is the wife of Mukesh's elder brother. Her eyes are filled with smoke. She greets the author with a faint smile. She is the Bahu of the family and commands due respect. Then Mukesh's father comes in. The young woman lowers her veil as the custom demands. Next. Despite long years of hard labor, first as tailor, then a bangle maker, he has failed. Who has failed? Mukesh's father has failed to renovate a house. He could not repair his house. He failed to repair his house. One, send his two sons to school. He couldn't send them school. All he has managed to do is teach them what he knows, the art of making bangles. Mukesh ke father apne bachchon ko keval aur keval ek hi baat sikha paaye, the art of making bangles. So school nahi bhej paaye, ghar ko repair nahi kar paaye. So this again shows the poor plight of these bangle makers. It is his karam, his identity, his destiny, sorry. It is his karma or his destiny, says Mukesh's grandmother, who has watched her own husband go blind with the dust from polishing the glass of bangles. Here it is highlighted how people go blind with the dust from polishing the glass of bangles. Can a God-given lineage ever be broken? Lineage here means ancestry. She implies born in the caste of bangle makers. They have seen nothing but bangles in the house, in the yard, in every other house, every other yard, every street in Firozabad. Spirals of bangles, sunny, gold, paddy green, royal blue, pink, purple, every color born out of the seven colors of the rainbow, lie in the mounds in unkempt yards or piled on four-wheeled hand carts. So Mukesh's grandmother has imbibed the fatalistic philosophy. She believes one is born in the caste according to one's karma. No one can change the caste God has given. They are destined to toil as bangle makers and go blind. Boys and girls sit with elder before flickering flames of oil lamps and weld colorful glass piece into rainbow colored bangles. They produce beautiful bangles. That adorn the wrists of happily married women, but in producing them, they starve and turn blind because they work in dark. Their eyes get adjusted to dark, daylight hurts them. They go blind before they are old. Fine. And then story moves further. Savita, a young girl in a drab pink dress, sits alongside an elderly woman, shouldering pieces of glass as her hands move mechanically like the tongs of a machine. I wonder if she knows the sanctity of the bangles she helped make. It symbolizes an Indian woman's suhag, auspiciousness in marriage. It will dawn on her suddenly one day when her head is draped with a red veil, her hands dyed red with henna, and red bangles rolled onto her wrists. She will then become a bride. So, writer says one day this girl come to know about the sanctity of bangles. What does a bangle signifies? Fine. So, it signifies Indian woman Suhag. Like the old woman beside her who became one many years ago, she still has bangles on her wrist but no light in her eyes. Ek waqt sher bhar khana bhi nahi khaya, she says in a voice drained of joy. She has not enjoyed even one full meal in her entire lifetime. That is what she has reaped. Her husband, an old man with flowing beard, says, I know nothing except bangles. All I have done is make a house for the family to live in. Hearing him, one wonders if he has achieved what many have failed in their lifetime. He has a roof over his head. The cry of not having money to do anything except carry on the business of making bangles, not even enough to eat, rings in every home. The young men echo the lament of their elders. Little has moved with time. It seems in Firozabad, years of mind-numbing toil have killed all initiatives and the ability to dream. So the people are living miserable life. They are failed to take any initiative. They have accepted everything as their destiny. People, children, elders, all are going blind. They are not thinking why they are involved in such a profession where they are not making much money, and at the same time they are losing their health, they are losing their eyes, they are going blind, they are unable to even repair their house, and from years they are living in a same kind of situation. So now the writer asks, why not organize yourselves into a cooperative? I ask a group of young men who have fallen into the vicious cycle of middlemen who trapped their fathers and forefathers. Even if we get organized, we are the one who will be hauled up by the police, beaten and dragged to jail for doing something illegal. They say, there is no leader among them, no one who could help them see things differently. They have no leader. There is no leader among them, no one who could help them see things differently. So they people are illiterate actually. They have no courage in them. They are fearful of the system. They think if they organize themselves into cooperative, police will beat them. Police will put them into jail. And no representative they have. There is no leader among them, no one who could help them see things differently. Their fathers are as tired as they are. They talk endlessly in a spiral that moves from poverty to apathy to greed and to injustice. So they just are beating the bush. They are just telling them the story. Fine, but they are unable to do anything. This is very interesting paragraph next. Listening to them, I see two distinct worlds. One of the family caught in a web of poverty, burdened by the stigma of caste in which they are born, one thing. The other, a vicious cycle of the sahukaras, the middlemen, the policemen, the keepers of law, the bureaucrats and the politicians. Together they have imposed the baggage on the child that he cannot put down. Before he is aware, he accepts it as naturally as his father. To do anything else would mean to dare, and daring is not part of his growing up. So the bangle makers are caught in a vicious web. There is hardly a way to escape. Firstly, their families are burdened with poverty and have the stigma of their caste. Secondly, there are the money lenders, middlemen, police, bureaucrats and politicians. They cannot escape their clutches. If they ever tried to make cooperative societies, the police dragged them to jail. They are helpless. They have no initiative. Fine. So these bangle makers have no ray of hope in their life. Fine. They are under the stigma of their caste. Fine. and even the middlemen, sahukaras, they all are trapped somewhere. Vicious means evil kind, wicked kind, and this is a kind of a trap. They can't come out from them. But the boy Mukesh is different. When I sense a flash of it in Mukesh, I am cheered. I want to be a motor mechanic. He repeats. He will go to a garage and learn. But the garage is a long way from his home. I will walk, he insists. Do you also dream of flying a plane? He is suddenly silent. No, he says, staring at the ground. In his small murmur, there is an embarrassment that has not yet turned into regret. He is content to dream of cars that he sees hurtling down the streets of his town. So he is contented. The author tries to check his clarity of his dream. She asks if he is interested in flying planes. So he clearly says he is not at all interested. He says few airplanes fly over Firozabad. Means no airplane fly over Firozabad because he has one single focus, and his focus is that he wants to be a motor mechanic. He wants to learn his job at a garage. He has hurdle in his way, but he has the daring. He has the daring to do something different. So this boy is totally different from Sahib-e-Alam. He dares. He dreams. He doesn't surrender before destiny. Sahib surrenders before destiny, but this boy has crystal clear goal and he is ready to achieve that goal. So we come across two stories. Fine. One story was from Simapuri and one is from Firozabad. Fine. Thank you.